our mouth. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, we come before you this morning with thanksgiving in our hearts. Just let's say thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord, for a brand new day. Bless you for this Women's Day. We want to thank you for all those that are here today. Our prayer, our faith, our choir. We pray thank you for our guest minister, Reverend Tisha, Dixon-Williams. We pray for all those that have come here and gathered today from their church. We want to just praise the Lord today on this Women's Day. We pray for all those that are here, all those that are on Zoom, and all those that are on the phone. Lord, let your will be done in this place on today. Let your Holy Spirit rest within the body of each one of us, Lord. Continue to bless and keep us throughout the day. We lift up our path before you this morning. We lift up the Reverend Tisha, I'm sorry. Thanks for being that you're coming forward with us for a word from you. So now may the words of my mouth and the meditation of my heart be acceptable in our sight. Lord, we thank you and we praise you.
We have a woman here who we watch every Sunday come forward and bring tea to our pastor. The nurse Esther Buck, to please come forward.
What you're doing. We thank you for who you are.
Thank you for all of your
given us, Lord God, and all of your many blessings. In Jesus' name we pray.
Pastor Tisha passionately believes that her life is a true reflection of Matthew 6, 33. But seek ye first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all these things will be added unto you. She resides in Bridgehampton, New York, with her husband, Deacon Larry Williams. I'm quite sure that this one sheet of paper cannot truly encapsulate all the woman of God that she is. But we pray to God that the Lord is going to do something mighty when she prays to the pulpit. So as the women's choir comes on one more time, the voice that you will hear after the women's choir will be in the person of Reverend Tisha Dixon-Williams. Let's prepare for the next choir.
mainly through mutual friends and certainly through preaching, but it wasn't until the murderers of Ahmaud Arbery were on trial. And one of the attorneys made the biggest mistake of his life and said, well, how many pastors does he have? We don't want any more pastors down here. Well, you might as well have told us all to come. And I was like, to support the family of Ahmaud Arbery. And so while ministry made us friends, it was that trip to Brunswick that made us siblings. And so that is a brother beloved. Can you one more time? The angel of this house. And I also want to celebrate and honor all of the other clergy who are here. God bless you, Reverend out of DC. God, I can see the work that you're doing here today. God bless you. And I want to also acknowledge, can you help me celebrate and acknowledge my husband who's here?
Amen. Yeah.
I'm locally traveling, and I want to honor our president of our women's ministry, Trustee Flora Gilliam. Thank you for being the time to bring us here. And then my sister, you are all my sisters and brothers for sure, but my sisters, my real select blood, biological, for real sister, is here. That's Sister Nicole Dixon, my sister. Nobody does it like women on Women's Day. We just do it, get dressed up, we march, we carry on. Now let me say something. I am used to people singing before I preach. This is the first time I ever saw a line dance break out. From the soles of his feet the crown of his head. Then Job took a piece of broken pottery and scraped himself with it as he sat among the ashes. His wife said to him, are you still maintaining your integrity? Curse God and die. He replied, you are talking like a foolish woman. Shall we accept good from God and not trouble? His wife said to him, are you still maintaining your integrity? Curse God and die. He replied, you are talking like a foolish woman.
Performance.
It's about the amount of screen time they had. It's their impact. It's character development. It's the range and versatility that they display. And it's their critical reception. And if, in fact, the criteria for best actress in a supporting role, then it is little wonder why Viola snagged the victory. She checked every box on her way to box office success. In fact, Viola Davis has won several awards in the supporting category throughout her career, not just the Oscar, but the Critics' Choice Award, the Golden Globe, the Screen Actors Guild Award, and all because of her ability to be the substructure of every scene. But church, as we consider the criteria for what it means to provide critical support, I wonder what would happen if we pulled an uno reverse and life imitated art. What are you saying, Pastor Tish? I'm saying somebody is sitting here today wondering what if humanity doled out awards for best support as ardently as the Academy. Because without doubt, we often laud the leads in our lives, and deservedly so, but I wish we would do more to celebrate the support. Somebody here is wondering, when's my time to get an award for the support I provide for everybody else? Everybody's thinking the same thing. Don't be embarrassed about it. You can think that. Somebody's wondering today, well, where's my award for best support? Where's my award for the role of best supporting friend in your romantic comedy? Where's my award for the best supporting brother in our family drama? Where's my award for best supporting neighbor that time I had to call the cops to your house? Somebody's sitting here wondering, where's my award? Because I've shown enough support for a lot of people in my day. Don't you wish that humanity doled out awards for best support as ardently as the Academy? Where's my award for best supporting money lender when you need to hold the whole sun till Friday? Where's my award for best supporting educator when I stayed after school to give your child reading support? Where's my award for best supporting community activists when people could not advocate for themselves? I'm just looking for some folks who'll be honest today and say, where's my award for being the best support in other people's lives? Don't you wish that humanity doled out awards for best support as ardently as the Academy? Well, in speaking to the New York Times about her approach to acting, Davis says she draws from some of the immersive elements of method acting. Well, when it came to her method of playing roles, I wonder, Pastor, if Mrs. Job was not her muse. But when we canvass the criteria of a stellar supporting performance, I must ask, have you considered Mrs. Job? For she too is deserving of an award as she meets every measure. Can I help you? In the book of Job, Mrs. Job plays a significant role in Job's story. Looking at her character through the lens of the award for best supporting actress, we can draw parallels that highlight her remarkable persistence in supporting Job. First of all, she has emotional range. Mrs. Job showcases this as she experiences a roller coaster of emotions alongside Job. She expresses despair, anger, frustration, and even moments of hope. Her emotional depth adds depth and complexity to her character, making her a compelling nominee. She has chemistry with the lead actor. Mrs. Job's chemistry, while often being chaotic with Job, is evident in their conversations and interactions. She challenges him, questions him, and provides a sounding board for his thoughts and emotions. Her presence enhances Job's character, creating a powerful dynamic that drives the narrative forward. She has an impactful moment. The Best Supporting Actress Award often recognizes standout scenes that leave a lasting impact on the audience. Mrs. Job's pivotal moment comes in Job 2 and 9 when she asks Job to curse God and die. This moment not only highlights her vulnerability, but also sets the stage for her subsequent growth and transformation. It's a powerful scene that showcases her internal struggle and adds depth to her character arc. Truly, Mrs. Job is the quintessential queen of support. She provides dimension, drawing power, and delivers in this pivotal scene. However, while she's a director's dream, for centuries, critics have considered her lacking in one area: strong character development. A supporting actress award, Mrs. Job is arguably one of the most controversial biblical personalities to have ever lived. Why?
because on the worst day of her life, she asks a question that causes everyone to question her character. However, church, the womanist in me can't let Mrs. Joe go out like that. Therefore, I'm going to go ahead and hit the reset button to reframe this ridiculous notion of resentment toward Mrs. Joe. Can I prove it to you? It's Cat Williams in his internet-breaking interview a few weeks ago helped us to understand there are no small parts, only small actors. A role is not limited to how many lines an actor has, but by the life the actor gives the lines. And as we scan Job's script, we find in chapter 2, scene 9, a one-liner delivered by Mrs. Job that sets her apart and solidifies her as the breakout star of the book. Do you mind if I flip the script? According to the book, Job is described as a wealthy and righteous man who fears God and avoids evil. However, God allows Satan to test Job's faith and loyalty. Here, a divine roll of the dice directed at Job makes Mrs. Job, their children, their livelihood, and their servants part of the pot. When Job is considered, everything connected to him becomes collateral damage. I know we love to sing "Everything Attached to Me Wins," but have you ever considered what's operating at a loss because it's attached to you? As a result, Job loses his wealth, his children, and his health, leaving him in a state of deep despair and disease as pustules now plague his body. Our scene begins with Job sitting in a heap of hurt, surrounded by ash and trash, in silence, soothing his broken soul, just as he uses shards of broken pottery to soothe his broken skin. And at this point, we've heard nothing from Mrs. Job. She too is silent. But as she enters the scene, she approaches Job, uttering her only line in the entire book, "Are you still maintaining your integrity? Curse God and die." I know what you're thinking. Don't look at me in that tone of voice. You're saying, what kind of woman would say such a thing at a time like this? But can I teach for a second? Help us, Rachel Schneiderman. You see, the word translated here as integrity means purity. It's also sometimes translated as innocence. Job's wife's question, "You still cling to your integrity," could be a past-looking pain point, a way of telling him that surely he must have done something wrong in the past to merit his current suffering, as she scoffs, "Do you still think you're so innocent?" However, this could also be a forward-looking prescription, telling him that it's fruitless to continue serving God since it's netted him nothing but woe. So maybe she's saying, "Will you really continue to praise God after all you've been through, baby?" We don't know. Did she bless? Did she curse? Is she boying him as in, "Boy, you still think you're so innocent?" Or is she babying him as in, "Will you really continue to praise God even in this?" We don't know. Was it boy or was it baby? In addition, the connecting half of her comment is likewise pregnant with possible meanings, because what's traditionally translated here as cursed is the word barak, which means blessed. So if we understand it as it's traditionally been understood as cursed, it means that she thinks Job shouldn't continue to serve God since God has betrayed him. We don't know. Did she boy? Did she baby? Did she bless or did she curse? And I know what you're thinking. It's cringy to consider that Mrs. Job is suggesting that her husband died by suicide. But she seems to believe he has nothing good left to live for. How sad that she doesn't even think herself worth living for. But perhaps it's better to understand her painful proposition through the lens of euthanasia. Maybe she wishes the suffering to end on his terms. Did she boy? Did she baby? Is she blessing him? Did she cursing him? Because what if Job's wife's statement literally means that he should bless God? What if she encourages him to bless God since he's already about to die? And she wants him to die with a prayer on his lips. If that's the case, then this is a tender scene. A wife giving her husband permission to pass peacefully. Oh, my dear heart, you still cling to death as you did until you still cling to your purity in death as you did in life. I'm so proud of you. Now that's all that's left for you to do is bless God and you can go. I'll be all right. present. Who could blame her? It's difficult to watch a loved one linger when the end of life is imminent. But then again, maybe it's just the opposite. Maybe sis got a mouth on her like so many of us do, and maybe she's using the word bless sarcastically, like, seriously, you gonna cling to your purity while God sits here and kills you by all means, do you, boo-boo? We don't know! Did she bless? Did she curse? Did she boy or did she baby? Church, there are so many possible interpretations to this line that it has confounded critics, scholars, and theologians for centuries. This conversation is not as cut and dry as we've been made to believe. And here's why. Because no one can confidently conclude what she said. Some scholars suggest she's canceling him. Other scholars suggest she's consoling him. This scholar suggests that this is a classic case of stay out of grown folks' business.
Talking
like a foolish woman. Foolish as in void of morals or values. Foolish as in you do not worship God. Mrs. Job is neither one of those things. Life is a comparison for the moment. He's comparing her to, not defining her as. Therefore, if Job is blameless and upright, Mrs. Job was blameless and upright. In addition, because Job was both pious and pagan, he would likely have been considered a pillar of the community or a patriarch, if you will. Some might even say, given his priestly nature and penchant for worshiping and shepherding, perhaps he even patterned a pastor of some sort, making Mrs. Job his first lady. He would have been married to someone with whom he was evenly yoked, with someone whom he shared both the values and vicissitudes of life. In other words, when Job got up to make sacrifices for the kids, Mrs. Job got up to make sacrifices for the kids. When Job went to check on his servants, Mrs. Job stood with him when he checked on the servants. When Job got up to serve the community, she got up, made him some coffee, pressed his clothes, made sure he was all right, and met him over there to serve the community. I'm suggesting today that she was his partner. She was standing with him as a partner, and she was standing with him in her role as a mother. One can never say what we would and would not do in seasons of trauma. See, we like to think we say all the right things and do all the right things, but we don't know how we would feel or react when we're triggered in times of trauma. But what I see here is a partner who wants to share in the grief of her beloved. Keep in mind, y'all, they were not only partners, they were parents. Parents whose nest had not been empty, it's been eviscerated. When Satan took God's bet, he not only killed Job's cattle, he killed their children. 10 children to be exact. 7 boys, 3 girls. She is a mother in mourning. She is mourning the loss of the baby she's birthed. She's mourning the loss of the children she nursed. She is mourning the loss as she relives every moment of labor and delivery. She's saying to Job, I know you want them to be delivered, but I delivered them. And yet she's still standing. And she continues to stand in the end. Okay, here's what's going to blow your mind. Here's what's interesting, y'all. If you fast forward to the end of the book, we find that Job is blessed with 10 additional children. Now, these are not replacement babies. These are not replacement babies. There is no replacing children. And so we have to learn to lean away from the harmful theology of double for your trouble. There is no doubling children. These are not replacement babies. These are brand new children with brand new lives. They're rainbow babies, symbolic that the storm has passed.
Yes.
And who gave birth to these babies, you might be asking? Yep, you got it.
This is Joe.
She bore 10 children at the peak of their marriage and 10 more upon the restoration of all that was destroyed. That's 20 children. You do the math. That's 1 kid every 2 year average. That means she was pregnant over a period of 40 years, barring twins. Lord have mercy. I'm going to say it like my friend Reverend Shaun J said. You give a man one baby, you might like him a little bit. Y'all might have something going on. You give a man one baby, you give a man 10 babies, you show him some of that baby. And ain't nobody coming out. Sat down, eh? accent of Mrs. Job. Nowhere in the text is there a record of Mrs. Job's reprimand. Here's the revelation. For all the resentment toward Mrs. Job, God never rebukes, revives, or replaces her. She's the right of the woman and the right of the heavenly. God never replaces her. I'm talking to the person right now who thinks you can't move beyond the worst thing you've ever done.
Yes.
offering. She's the personification of it, that ain't one thing, it's another. And nevertheless, she's standing even as the world is tilting. Standing. Even when the world is off its axis, she's still standing. We can choose to face the storm with defiance, but with hope. A sliver that whispers God is still there. The reason I believe she's standing is because God was still standing with her. And she stands in the absence of her children. When her husband is depressed and suicidal, nevertheless, she stands. She stands like so many women throughout our history. When I see Mrs. Job here, I see Harriet Tubman standing in the hush hollers, urging our people toward freedom. When Mrs. Job stands, I see Mahalia Jackson standing behind Martin, pushing him to tell people about the dream. When Mrs. Job is standing, I see Rosa Parks taking her stand against segregated bus driving. Don't you know today, we come from a long
I'm
they don't have the strength. The reason that we have to be so careful, especially these days, we don't know what people are going through.
Right.
We quite literally only see the tip of the iceberg.
Yes.
We see this much of what's happening with us.
Yes.
And under the surface, there's a whole world.
That's right.
That we don't know anything about. Most of us are like ducks on water. We look real good coasting on the surface. But underneath our little feet are going 100 miles an hour on our back. So to the sister who's crying over everything, to the sister who lives, this is it for you. I want you to know that this God has a whole new future for you.
Yes.
Aren't you glad today that God still has the plan?
Dixon-Williams in your memo. Make sure you put that in the love of the voice, the guest speaker. You can give online using our cell. You can also give online using our cash app as well. Hallelujah, we will receive it. And maybe you've been blessed. Once the ushers get through, maybe you've been blessed by this powerful word. And you've been compelled, and you know that it's time for you to give your life to the Lord. This is the moment where we are extending an invitation to receive Christ as your Lord and personal Savior. Amen? After you've given your offering, your monetary offering, maybe someone is ready to give their life to Christ.
Stay standing.
This is your moment. This is your day. And once the ushers have passed, our deacons are going to come. Thank you so much. Thank you so much. Thank you so much. Amen. God bless you. God bless you. God bless you. Amen. Amen. And perhaps this word, as we said earlier, touched you to the core today. Perhaps you've been trembling at the knees and you've been trying to keep your balance to remain upright. And you need some support. Well, you've come to the right place at the right time and you need to get in touch with your Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. We are extending this invitation to you this afternoon. We have some deacons that are going to come with open arms to receive you. You want to keep standing, you want to remain standing, this is your time. This is your time. Need some help standing. Life's been hard. And you need the strength of the Lord, the help of the Lord to hold you up. Will you come? He desires that no man, no woman should perish. Will you come? Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Will you come? Will you accept the Lord Jesus Christ as your Lord and personal Savior?
Just a little bit more about you in Jesus' name.
Jesus' name. And now as we dismiss from this setting, we pray for traveling mercies to all of those who are near and far. And we pray, God, that you continue to bless us and keep us as only you can. And now as we dismiss from this setting, we know we never depart from your divine care. It is my sincere prayer, God, that you do something amazing for us and to us and through us in this week. And now may the love of God and the sweet communion of the Holy Spirit rest with you and abide with your people both now and